Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of two short novels by D.H. Lawrence, The Ladybird, narrated by Margaret Hilton, and Love Among the Haystacks, narrated by Victoria Morgan. These works are copyrighted 1923 by Frieda Lawrence, copyright renewed 1951. This recording is copyrighted 1987 by Recorded Books, Incorporated. And now, The Ladybird, narrated by Margaret Hilton.
How many swords had Lady Beveridge in her pierced heart? Yet there always seemed room for another, since she had determined that her heart of pity and kindness should never die. If it had not been for this determination, she herself might have died of sheer agony in the years 1916 and 1917, when her boys were killed and her brother, and death seemed to be mowing with wide swathes through her family. But let us forget. Lady Beveridge loved humanity, and come what might, she would continue to love it. Nay, in the human sense, she would love her enemies. Not the criminals among the enemy, the men who committed atrocities, but the men who were enemies through no choice of their own. She would be swept into no general hate. Somebody had called her the soul of England. It was not ill said, though she was half Irish, but of an old, aristocratic, loyal family, famous for its brilliant men. And she, Lady Beveridge, had for years as much influence on the tone of English politics as any individual alive. The close friend of the real leaders in the House of Lords and in the Cabinet, she was content that the men should act, so long as they breathed from her, as from the rose of life, the pure fragrance of truth and genuine love. She had no misgiving regarding her own spirit. She would never lower her delicate silken flag. For instance, throughout all the agony of the war, she never forgot the enemy prisoners. She was determined to do her best for them. During the first year, she still had influence, but during the last years of the war, power slipped out of the hands of her and her sort, and she found she could do nothing anymore, almost nothing. Then it seemed as if the many swords had gone home into the heart of this little, unyielding Marta Dolorosa. The new generation jeered at her. She was a shabby, old-fashioned little aristocrat, and her drawing room was out of date. But we anticipate. The years 1916 and 1917 were the years when the old spirit died forever in England. But Lady Beveridge struggled on. She was being beaten. It was in the winter of 1917, or in the late autumn. She had been for a fortnight sick, stricken, paralyzed by the fearful death of her youngest boy. She felt she must give in and just die. And then she remembered how many others were lying in agony. So she rose, trembling, frail, to pay a visit to the hospital where lay the enemy sick and wounded near London. Countess Beveridge was still a privileged woman. Society was beginning to jeer at this little worn bird of an out-of-date righteousness and aesthetic, but they dared not think ill of her. She ordered the car and went alone. The Earl, her husband, had taken his gloom to Scotland. So, on a sunny, warm November morning, Lady Beveridge descended at the hospital, Hurst Place. The guard knew her and saluted as she passed. Ah, she was used to such deep respect. It was strange that she felt it so bitterly when the respect became shallower. But she did. It was the beginning of the end to her. The matron went with her into the ward. Alas, the beds were all full, and men were even lying on pallets on the floor. There was a desperate, crowded dreariness and helplessness in the place, as if nobody wanted to make a sound or utter a word. Many of the men were haggard and unshaven. One was delirious and talking fitfully in the Saxon dialect. It went to Lady Beveridge's heart. She had been educated in Dresden and had had many dear friendships in the city. Her children also had been educated there. She heard the Saxon dialect with pain. She was a little, frail, bird-like woman, elegant, but with that touch of the blue stocking of the 90s, which was unmistakable. She fluttered delicately from bed to bed, speaking in perfect German, but with a thin English intonation, and always asking if there was anything she could do. The men were mostly officers and gentlemen. They made little requests, which she wrote down in a book. Her long, pale, rather worn face, and her nervous little gestures somehow inspired confidence. One man lay quite still, with his eyes shut. He had a black beard. His face was rather small and sallow. He might be dead. Lady Beveridge looked at him earnestly, and fear came into her face. "Why, Count Dionys," she said, fluttered. "Are you asleep?" It was Count Johann Dionys Psanik, a Bohemian. She had known him when he was a boy, and only in the spring of 1914 he and his wife had stayed with Lady Beveridge in her country house in Leicestershire. His black eyes opened. Large, black, unseeing eyes with curved black lashes. He was a small man, small as a boy, and his face too was rather small. But all the lines were fine, as if they had been fired with a keen male energy. Now the yellowish, swarthy paste of his flesh seemed dead, and the fine black brows seemed drawn on the face of one dead. The eyes, however, were alive, but only just alive, unseeing and unknowing. "You know me, Count Dionys. You know me, don't you?" said Lady Beveridge, bending forward over the bed. There was no reply for some time. Then the black eyes gathered a look of recognition, and there came the ghost of a polite smile. "Lady Beveridge." The lips formed the words. There was practically no sound. "I am so glad you can recognize me, and I am so sorry you are hurt. I am so sorry." The black eyes watched her from that terrible remoteness of death, without changing. "There is nothing I can do for you. Nothing at all," she said, always speaking German. And after a time, and from a distance, came the answer from his eyes, a look of weariness, of refusal, and a wish to be left alone. He was unable to strain himself into consciousness. His eyelids dropped. "I am so sorry," she said. "If ever there is anything I can do..." The eyes opened again, looking at her. He seemed at last to hear, and it was as if his eyes made the last weary gesture of a polite bow. Then slowly his eyelids closed again. Poor Lady Beveridge felt another sword thrust of sorrow in her heart as she stood looking down at the motionless face and at the fine black beard. The black hairs came out of his skin thin and fine, not very close together. A queer, dark, aboriginal little face he had, with a fine nose. Not an Aryan, surely. And he was going to die. He had a bullet through the upper part of his chest, and another bullet had broken one of his ribs. He had been in hospital 5 days. Lady Beveridge asked the matron to ring her up if anything happened. Then she drove away, saddened. Instead of going to Beveridge House, she went to her daughter's flat near the park, near Hyde Park. Lady Daphne was poor. She had married a commoner, son of one of the most famous politicians in England, but a man with no money. And Earl Beveridge had wasted most of the large fortune that had come to him, so that the daughter had very little, comparatively. Lady Beveridge suffered going in the narrow doorway into the rather ugly flat. Lady Daphne was sitting by the electric fire in the small yellow drawing room, talking to a visitor. She rose at once, seeing her little mother. "Why, mother, ought you to be out? I'm sure not." "Yes, Daphne, darling, of course I ought to be out." "How are you?" The daughter's voice was slow and sonorous, protective, sad. Lady Daphne was tall, only 25 years old. She had been one of the beauties when the war broke out, and her father had hoped she would make a splendid match. Truly she had married fame, but without money. Now, sorrow, pain, thwarted passion, had done her great damage. Her husband was missing in the East. Her baby had been born dead. Her two darling brothers were dead. And she was ill, always ill. A tall, beautifully built girl, she had the fine stature of her father. Her shoulders were still straight, but how thin her white throat. She wore a simple black frock stitched with coloured wool round the top, and held in a loose-coloured girdle, otherwise no ornaments. And her face was lovely, fair, with a soft, exotic white complexion and delicate pink cheeks. Her hair was soft and heavy, of a lovely pallid gold colour, ash blonde. Her hair, her complexion, were so perfectly cared for as to be almost artificial, like a hothouse flower. But alas, her beauty was a failure. She was threatened with phthisis and was far too thin. Her eyes were the saddest part of her. They had slightly reddened rims, nerve-worn, with heavy, veined lids that seemed as if they did not want to keep up. The eyes themselves were large and of a beautiful green-blue colour, but they were full, languid, almost glaucous. Standing as she was, a tall, finely built girl, looking down with affectionate care on her mother, she filled the heart with ashes. The little pathetic mother, so wonderful in her way, was not really to be pitied for all her sorrow. Her life was in her sorrows, and her efforts on behalf of the sorrows of others. But Daphne was not born for grief and philanthropy. With her splendid frame and her lovely, long, strong legs, she was Artemis, or Atalanta, rather than Daphne. There was a certain width of brow and even of chin that spoke a strong, reckless nature, and the curious, distraught slant of her eyes told of a wild energy dammed up inside her. That was what ailed her, her own wild energy. She had it from her father and from her father's desperate race. The earldom had begun with a riotous, daredevil border soldier, and this was the blood that flowed on. And alas, what was to be done with it? Daphne had married an adorable husband, truly an adorable husband, whereas she needed a daredevil. But in her mind, she hated all daredevils. She had been brought up by her mother to admire only the good. So her reckless anti-philanthropic passion could find no outlet, and should find no outlet, she thought. So her own blood turned against her, beat on her own nerves, and destroyed her. It was nothing but frustration and anger which made her ill, and made the doctors fear consumption. There it was, drawn on her rather wide mouth. Frustration, anger, bitterness. There it was, the same in the roll of her green-blue eyes, a slanting, averted look. The same anger furtively turning back on itself. This anger reddened her eyes and shattered her nerves, and yet her whole will was fixed in her adoption of her mother's creed, and in condemnation of her handsome, proud, brutal father, who had made so much misery in the family. Yes, her will was fixed in the determination that life should be gentle and good and benevolent, whereas her blood was reckless, the blood of daredevils. Her will was the stronger of the two, but her blood had its revenge on her. So it is with strong natures today, shattered from the inside. "You have no news, darling?" asked the mother. "No. My father-in-law had information that British prisoners had been brought into Hazran and that details would be forwarded by the Turks. And there was a rumour from some Arab prisoners that Basil was one of the British brought in wounded." "When did you hear this?"
"Primrose came in this morning."
"Then we can hope, dear."
"Yes." Never was anything more dull and bitter than Daphne's affirmative of hope. Hope had become almost a curse to her. She wished there need be no such thing. Ha! The torment of hoping, and the insult to one's soul. Like the importunate widow dunning for her deserts, why could it not all be just clean disaster and have done with it? This dilly-dallying with despair was worse than despair. She had hoped so much. Ah! For her darling brothers she had hoped with such anguish. And the two she loved best were dead. So were most others she had hoped for, dead. Only this uncertainty about her husband still rankling.
"You feel better, dear?" said the little unquenched mother.
"Rather better," came the resentful answer.
"And your night?"
"No better." There was a pause.
"You're coming to lunch with me, Daphne, darling?"
"No, mother dear. I promised to lunch at the Howards with Primrose. But I needn't go for a quarter of an hour. Do sit down." Both women seated themselves near the electric fire. There was that bitter pause, neither knowing what to say. Then Daphne roused herself to look at her mother.
"Are you sure you were fit to go out?" she said. "What took you out so suddenly?" "I went to Hurst Place, dear. I had the men on my mind.
after the way the newspapers have been talking. Why ever do you read the newspapers? Blurted Daphne, with a certain burning, acid anger. Well, she said, more composed. And do you feel better now you've been?
So many people suffer besides ourselves, darling.
I know they do, makes it all the worse. It wouldn't matter if it were only just us. At least, it would matter, but one could bear it more easily. To be just one of a crowd, all in the same state.
And some even worse, dear.
Oh, quite. Then the worse it is for all, the worse it is for one.
Is that so, darling? Try not to see too darkly. I feel if I can give just a little bit of myself to help the others, you know, it alleviates me. I feel that what I can give to the men lying there, Daphne, I give to my own boys. I can only help them now through helping others. But I can still do that, Daphne, my girl.
And the mother put a little white hand into the long, white, cold hand of her daughter. Tears came to Daphne's eyes and a fearful, stony grimace to her mouth.
It's so wonderful of you that you can feel like that, she said.
But you feel the same, my love, I know you do.
No, I don't.
Everyone I see suffering these same awful things, it makes me wish more for the end of the world, and I quite see that the world won't end. But it will get better, dear. This time it's like a great sickness, like a terrible pneumonia tearing the breast of the world.
Do you believe it will get better?
I don't.
It will get better. Of course it will get better. It is perverse to think otherwise, Daphne. Remember what has been before, even in Europe.
Ah, Daphne, we must take a bigger view.
Yes, I suppose we must.
The daughter spoke rapidly, from the lips, in a resonant, monotonous tone. The mother spoke from the heart.
And Daphne, I found an old friend among the men at Hurst Place.
Who?
Little Count Dionys. You remember him?
Quite. What's wrong?
Wounded rather badly, through the chest, so ill.
Did you speak to him?
Yes. I recognized him in spite of his beard.
Beard?
Yes, a black beard.
I suppose he could not be shaven. It seems strange he's still alive, poor man.
Why strange?
He isn't old. How old is he?
Between 30 and 40. But so ill, so wounded, Daphne. So small. So small, so sallow. Smorto, you know the Italian word. The way dark people look. There's something so distressing in it.
Does he look very small now?
Uncanny? Asked the daughter.
No, not uncanny.
Something of the terrible far-awayness of a child that is very ill and can't tell you what hurts it.
Poor Count Dionys, Daphne.
I didn't know, dear, that his eyes were so black and his lashes so curved and long. I had never thought of him as beautiful.
Nor I. Only a little comical. Such a dapper little man.
Yes. And yet now, Daphne, there is something remote and a sad heroic in his dark face. Something primitive.
What did he say to you?
He couldn't speak to me. Only with his lips. Just my name.
So bad as that.
Oh, yes. They are afraid he will die.
Poor Count Dionys.
I liked him. He was a bit like a monkey, but he had his points.
He gave me a thimble on my 17th birthday. Such an amusing thimble.
I remember, dear.
Unpleasant wife, though. Wonder if he minds dying far away from her. Wonder if she knows.
I think not. They didn't even know his name properly, only that he was a colonel of such and such a regiment.
4th Cavalry, said Daphne.
Poor Count Dionys. Such a lovely name, I always thought. Count Johann Dionys Psanek.
Extraordinarily dandy he was, and an amazingly good dancer, small yet electric. Wonder if he minds dying.
He was so full of life in his own little animal way. They say small people are always conceited, but he doesn't look conceited now, dear. Something ages old in his face, and, yes, a certain beauty, Daphne.
You mean long lashes?
No, so still, so solitary, and ages old in his race. I suppose he must belong to one of those curious little aboriginal races of Central Europe. I felt quite new beside him.
How nice of you, said Daphne.
Nevertheless, next day Daphne telephoned to Hurst Place to ask for news of him. He was about the same. She telephoned every day. Then she was told he was a little stronger. The day she received the message that her husband was wounded and a prisoner in Turkey and that his wounds were healing, she forgot to telephone for news of the little enemy count. And the following day she telephoned that she was coming to the hospital to see him. He was awake, more restless, more in physical excitement. They could see the nausea of pain round his nose. His face seemed to Daphne curiously hidden behind the black beard, which nevertheless was thin, each hair coming thin and fine, singly, from the sallow, slightly translucent skin. In the same way his moustache made a thin black line round his mouth. His eyes were wide open, very black, and of no legible expression. He watched the two women coming down the crowded, dreary room, as if he didn't see them. His eyes seemed too wide. It was a cold day, and Daphne was huddled in a black sealskin coat with a skunk collar pulled up to her ears and a dull gold cap with wings pulled down on her brow. Lady Beveridge wore her sable coat and had that odd, untidy elegance which was natural to her, rather like a ruffled chicken. Daphne was upset by the hospital. She looked from right to left in spite of herself, and everything gave her a dull feeling of horror. The terror of these sick, wounded enemy men. She loomed tall and obtrusive in her furs by the bed, her little mother at her side. "I hope you don't mind my coming," she said, in German, to the sick man. Her tongue felt rusty, speaking the language. "Who is it, then?" he asked. "It is my daughter, Lady Daphne. You remembered me, Lady Beveridge. This is my daughter, whom you knew in Saxony. She was so sorry to hear you were wounded." The black eyes rested on the little lady. Then they returned to the looming figure of Daphne, and a certain fear grew on the low, sick brow. It was evident the presence loomed and frightened him. He turned his face aside. Daphne noticed how his fine black hair grew uncut over his small animal ears. "You don't remember me, Count Dionys," she said dully. "Yes," he said, but he kept his face averted. She stood there, feeling confused and miserable, as if she had made a faux pas in coming. "Would you rather be left alone?" she said. "I'm sorry." Her voice was monotonous. She felt suddenly stifled in her closed furs, and threw her coat open, showing her thin white throat and plain black slip dress on her flat breast. He turned again, unwillingly, to look at her. He looked at her as if she were some strange creature standing near him. "Goodbye," she said. "Do get better." She was looking at him with a queer, slanting, downward look of her heavy eyes as she turned away. She was still a little red round the eyes with nervous exhaustion. "You are so tall," he said, still frightened. "I was always tall," she replied, turning half to him again. "And I, small," he said. "I am so glad you are getting better," she said. "I am not glad," he said. "Why, I'm sure you are, just as we are glad, because we want you to get better. Thank you," he said. "I have wished to die." "Don't do that, Count Dionys. Do get better," she said, in the rather deep, laconic manner of her girlhood. He looked at her with a father look of recognition, but his short, rather pointed nose was lifted with the disgust and weariness of pain. His brows were tense. He watched her with that curious flame of suffering, which is forced to give a little outside attention, but which speaks only to itself. "Why did they not let me die?" he said. "I wanted death now." "No," she said, "you mustn't. You must live. If we can live, we must." "I wanted death," he said. "Ah, well," she said, "even death we can't have when we want it.
or when we think we want it.
That is true, he said, watching her with the same wide black eyes. Please to sit down. You are too tall as you stand. It was evident he was a little frightened still by her looming, overhanging figure.
I am sorry I am too tall, she said, taking a chair which a man nurse had brought her.
Lady Beveridge had gone away to speak with the men. Daphne sat down, not knowing what to say further. The pitch-black look in the Count's wide eyes puzzled her.
Why do you come here? Why does your lady mother come? He said.
To see if we can do anything, she answered.
When I am well, I will thank your ladyship.
All right, she replied. When you are well, I will let my lord the Count thank me. Please do get well.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.